When I was a kid, I was fascinated by those big citrons. They just sort of floated along majestically. They had headlamps that could see round corners and were so low they appeared to have no wheels at all. They'd whir and tick and hiss and curtsy oddly as you got in and out. To a car-crazy 10-year-old, they were the maddest thing I'd ever seen and looked just like a spaceship that had fallen from the sky. This is the story of a Gallic goddess, the Citroën DS. When the car was launched, it literally rocked the world. People were amazed. No other single event since the death of Stalin had generated as much publicity and as many column inches. Remember, this was 1955, when the world was just getting over the excitement of electric razors. Then along comes this slipstreamed, futuristic vision, and everybody just went, wow. On the day of its launch, Citroën drove a convoy of the things up the Champs-Élysées and were pursued by hundreds of people shouting, une déesse, voilà la déesse. And today, 40 years on, you look at it and it is still like something from another world.
It was like riding on a magic carpet. It was fast, it was sleek, it was very, very comfortable. Above all, it was different.
Even today, it is still such an unusual item. It is a marvellous thing to drive.
It was the most rational and revolutionary car of all time.
You can drive any car along, but if you're driving this along the road, heads still turn to look at it.
It was incredible. Just loved it.
The DS's revolutionary forebear was the 1934 Traction Avant, one of France's favourite cars, until the Gestapo commandeered them all during the war. Citroën tried to keep the Traction's replacement a deadly secret, but in one of the first motor industry scoops, the French car magazine, L'Auto Journal, splashed a prototype across its pages no less than 3 years before the car's launch. But the secrecy continued. At the 1955 Paris Motor Show, even after all the other cars had taken up residence on the stands, there was still a pregnant hole awaiting the Citroën. But 45 minutes after it did appear, 749 people had put in orders. At the end of the first day, no less than 12,000 had paid a deposit for the brave new Citroën. Driven by Gina Lollobrigida, it made the front cover of Paris Match and just about every newspaper in the world. And it was as radical to drive as it was to look at. There was no clutch. You had a semi-automatic gearbox. That's why you see all DS drivers with their hand perched neatly on the top of the wheel, ready to just click the lever along like that. Works extremely well. The single-spoke steering was power-assisted, and it was front-wheel drive, shod with specially designed Michelin radials. It was the first production car to have front disc brakes, hydraulic, of course, but instead of a conventional pedal, you had a mushroom-shaped button on the floor. Only the French. And the big Citroën's greatest technical ingenuity, and remember this was 1955, was its self-leveling hydropneumatic suspension, which supported the car on a cushion of fluid and made it ride like the prototype magic carpet.
The elasticity of the air and the flexibility of water are combined for your comfort in the Citroën hydropneumatic suspension. Each wheel is linked to the body by a piston. This piston acts on a liquid which compresses a gas contained in a suspension sphere. The counter effects of these elements maintains the body horizontal at all times.
Now it became possible to sit the car not on metal springs, but on four bubbles of compressed nitrogen. And a compressed gas, a trapped gas, is the finest spring you can get. Because you had this high pressure circuitry for operating the suspension and operating the brakes, which incidentally enabled you to have really powerful brakes at the front where all the work was primarily done, Citroën made their own disc brakes. because nobody else's were good enough, of course. And so this was the first production car to have disc brakes, and very well they worked too.
In fact, the whole thing worked well, and even today, some say that for a mass-produced car, the DS is technically unsurpassed. The DS was so ahead of itself that in its 20-year lifespan, it was hardly changed at all. The only major revision came in 1967, when Citroën sharpened up that nose and gave it its shark snout. Plus, of course, its most famous party trick, headlamps that swiveled with the steering. So proud was Citroën of this avant-garde device that they indulged it with its very own bit of cinema.
This is a car that was made way ahead of its time. It was made in the past, but definitely has a place in the future. My first impressions of the DS were formed as a small child watching programs like Thunderbirds and Stingray, and the shape of the DS, that kind of bulbous and then tapered off shape, and reminded me of Thunderbird 2, a big pod carrier that used to carry Thunderbird 4 around, and also Stingray as well. So when I first saw a DS, I thought, wow, they've actually got a Stingray on wheels. I called my car Imelda after Imelda Marcos, because at the time when I bought the car, she was being indicted for fraud and in the Philippines, and it just seemed an appropriate name to call it at the time. Also, she's gorgeous and she's brown. Aesthetically, she's very pleasing to the eye. Most people, when they see her for the first time, look at her lines and her shape, her curve and her big bulbous eyes. When you drive one of these, people can't help but to look at you. You can pull up next to a Porsche or you can pull up next to a Range Rover and they can't touch you. You can raise or lower the suspension and you're in a class of your own. You're driving a car that's got more history, more style, more impact than most cars on the street today. Also, it's got a lot of chrome on it.
Acres of legroom and a cavernous boot meant that the DS was hugely practical and very, very, very accommodating. Bristling with all those clever little touches that mean so much. And that amazing suspension made the DS one of the few cars in the world that could perform a trick like this. Indeed, the philosopher Roland Barthes was so captivated by the car that he dedicated an entire essay to it, arguing that it was the 20th century equivalent of the medieval Gothic cathedral. He compared its seamless lines to the unbroken metal of the spaceships of science fiction. Firmly ingrained in French culture, it was the vehicle for visiting state dignitaries. De Gaulle gave Nixon the full Citroën treatment in 1969 with his special and very enlarged DS presidential model. In fact, De Gaulle wouldn't be driven around in anything else because he owed his life to a DS. In 1962, his car was sprayed with bullets by terrorists, and only because the DS could be driven with two flat tires was he able to make his escape. A bullet passed just 8 inches away from that famous nose. And it's still a symbol of everything Gallic the world over. The natural choice to evoke a nostalgic journey through rural France for this British advert for a British bank. I can't think of any other cars that so perfectly embody the national characteristics of the people that made them, like the Citroën DS. It is so terribly, terribly French. Think about it. It's arrogant, yet soft and easygoing. Chic and stylish, yet somehow strangely conservative. Wildly eccentric, yet also in a way very, very practical. And when British motorists bought the DS in the 60s and 70s, and there weren't that many of them, they were paying homage to one of the most idiosyncratic and quirky races in the world. In those days, in England, if you wanted a DS, you had to be a serious Francophile. Like Jane and Alan Clark, who have an enduring love affair with their ultra-rare Décapitable. It's one of only a few hundred convertible DS's made by the French coach builder Chaperon.
Lovely. It's absolutely lovely because it just simply holds the road so beautifully. It's very, very light. It's got a very light steering. You have to be... You hardly have to move the wheel. It's just a joy. It's just lovely. It's mine. It's registered in my name, and it was the last one made in the Chaperon factory. And Madame Chaperon used to appear from her little booth when we used to go and see how it was getting on, really, see how the colours were coming on. He likes me to drive it, but he really prefers me to Macri so that he can drive it.
It's a personal car for Jane and I. We only use it on our holidays, which we always take in France. It has this beautiful look, it's got a streamlined, like some marvellous giant fish of the Pacific. It's completely undated. It looks very, very smart even now. And what I love about it is it's handling. It's the best combination of comfort and really good handling that you can get anywhere. And of course, on bad French roads, with knee de poule, as they so expressively call them, and quick changes of camber and bad verges, broken verges, and a lot of puddles and rain and so on, it's unbeatable, the Citroën, really. You can't get past them, and you can't shake them off if they're driven by a determined Frenchman. My wife owns this car, and she does get to drive it. I mean, she's very kind to me in 100 different ways, and she lets me drive it. But to tell you the truth, when she's driving me, I'm almost happier and more relaxed than when I'm driving it myself. She doesn't throw it about the way I sometimes do under temptation.
British buyers hardly took to the DS in a big way, but those who did tended to be cerebral, wealthy professionals who appreciated the DS's designer individuality and who didn't balk at the car's steep price and high running costs. And my destination makes it worth the while. The model they admired the most was the Safari, one of the biggest estates of its day. Still another mile. Ideal transport for large middle-class families and perhaps the original people carrier. Something
good in everything. Wonderful to look at and a technical tour de force, the DS cost an awful lot of money, £2,000. Yet, a Rover 2000 or a Triumph 2000 were only half as much. And if you wanted to spend a wee bit more and go seriously upmarket, you could drive home in a spanking new Mercedes 250 SE. So you can understand why, in Britain at least, the DS never broke any sales records.
In fact, it only really sold well in France. Most of the 1.5 million made over 20 years were sold there. In other countries, the car's complexity fell on stony ground. Buyers were intimidated rather than impressed. But some British motorists actually found the car's charming idiosyncrasies rather useful, not least that special suspension.
I was driving through Kingston in Surrey one day, and in a torrential downpour, and we came into a dip in the road, and at the bottom of the dip was under a railway bridge, and there was a queue of cars. And they were all going through like this very slowly, you know, almost shaking like a dog when they got out of the puddle, because it was about that deep, you see. So when I came to the head of the queue, I just went, and I put my suspension up, revved up, and the suspension went onto its top setting, and I went through like a tank, you know, straight through, to everyone going, ah, oh, because I just put the suspension down, as soon as I got out of the puddle, and on I went, and it was lovely.
And raising the suspension made changing the wheels an absolute breeze, even if you did have to take the rear wing off first. The Deus was so advanced that in 1960 it was chosen by the Transport and Road Research Laboratory as a testbed for a sort of autopilot for cars.
I've driven this car for hundreds of miles without touching the steering wheel.
A driverless steering system picked up electronic signals from sensors buried in the track and literally steered itself.
We used the Citroën DS because it had the only high-pressure hydraulic system which we would use to automatically steer the car. We could drive the car up to 80 miles an hour without touching the steering wheel, and 60 miles an hour in the snow, when it was more stable than the average driver.
Today, a well-preserved DS commands less than £5,000, but being at the cutting edge of automotive technology didn't stop them rusting away very quickly indeed. Rebuilding an old one can be a light sentence.
It's a Citroën DS23, 1974. First registered in 75 and one of the last to hit the English roads. One owner from New. Low mileage, 68,000, and quite an attractive registration number, but needs a lot doing to it. This particular one is rather worse than I dared hope. It basically needs rebuilding from the front seats backwards. I would have thought, with a little bit of help from my friends, and fortunately in this parish I've got some very good ones, it could be done in a couple of years, something like that.
Elegant, fragile, eccentric, but tragically misunderstood, it's hard not to be passionate about the Citroën DS, one of the world's most distinctive, complicated, but ultimately romantic cars.
I think, if anything, it's the same as the Rolls, actually, the Rolls-Royce. Anything that is of a superb design lives. And this lives, you know, this it's so beautifully crafted, and the suspension, you know, is the best in the world.
Styling is very characteristically French. What I love about the Citroën D series is that both in engineering and in styling, they are totally and individually French. And they were really the last expression of French genius in automobile engineering, I think.
High-speed edition of Top Gear this week has Michael Schumacher in the driving seat of the new Ford Mustang. That's on Thursday evening at 8:30 here on BBC Two.
Carlo in third place and